one of the first things you need to do before you begin to teach anyone anything is to set goals for your teaching. To set goals for your teaching. What does this teaching seek to achieve? For instance, today, I want to stretch you. I want to give you something to do. Keep you thinking as a teacher. You put your eyes and your understanding as a task ahead of you. There's much being expected of the teaching minister in the body of Christ. Praise God. See, if you don't know what you are doing or where you are going, then how will people follow you? They will also be roaming about. So there should be a clear-cut goal. That is why sometimes when you are giving a talk to prepare, if you don't understand, ask the person with you, what do you expect from this teaching? It's about a goal. Because you may give a good message, but outside the expectation.
Yeah.
So what do you expect from this message? Sometimes I ask that question. What do you expect to get from this? I want to guide you. And that is what you will use to judge the success or otherwise. Not how long you spoke, not how well you even spoke. It's all like track race, you are track one. Or your master, bam, you enter track two. And even come first. They will not give you the award or the crown, the trophy, whatever. Even though you spent energy, even though the crowd cheered for you, you understand? Clap hands for you, and you came first. You didn't go according to the rules, so you will not take any time. So teaching is very delicate. It's much more than what many people think. Or because we lack the requisite training. Praise God.
Amen.
All right. Two basic goals for your teaching. Two basic goals for teaching. Number one, teach people how to think. Teach people how to think. If you will say that it's not thought for life change. He said to Simon, what do you think? What do you need to think? When Simon was talking about, this man doesn't know that this person is. He said, hey, Simon, what do you think? Teach people how to think. If you want somebody's life to change, his thoughts, okay, should change. It's just that the thoughts in this aspect is used interchangeably between the mind and the heart. Sometimes they are used interchangeably. For instance, Proverbs chapter 23, verse 7 says, as a man thinks, where? No, as he thinks where?
In the heart.
In his heart. So do you use your heart to think or do you use your head to think? Find out as you have to spend. Okay, so there is a process that can start in the head, but until it gets to the heart. The heart is the seat of life. That is where change takes place. Just as a man thinks, not in his head. But in his heart. So if you want to change somebody's life, change his way of thinking. Once you can change the way you think, your behavior, your character can change. When you are trying to change somebody's character, you start affecting what he thinks. It will be very difficult. So if you get people to think, that's why philosophers rule the world. Philosophers. Love, also knowledge, has been of philosophy, love of knowledge. They are so much in love of knowledge that they try to impregnate themselves. And that has been of philosophize. They try to impregnate themselves. They ask themselves. And that, as I'm talking to you, they talk to themselves. You understand it? That is what philosophize. They are so much in knowledge, they keep on impregnating themselves. They keep on coming out with concepts. Philosophy. So much in love of knowledge. You look at this and they begin to ask themselves, why is it called answer in the first place? Mm-hmm. How do you mean that? They begin to, in discuss, have intercourse with themselves. Discuss with themselves. They wouldn't talk like monks. They wouldn't mind. Leave, go to desert just to go and think about it. That's it. Praise God.
Amen.
So teach people first of all how to think. Your duty as a teacher is to stretch the human mind. Help people to think differently. That will result in their acting differently. Romans chapter 12 verse 2 says we should not be conformed to this world. Instead, we should renew our mind so that we'll be able to prove that which is good, acceptable, and the perfect will of God, according to King James Version, which is what we call the gap principle. The gap principle. Good, acceptable, and perfect. The will of God. Do you remember that Jesus called the first book of the church Satan? Matthew chapter 6.
Yes.
Mark chapter 8. Why? He gave a caveat. Gave a reason. See, because of the way you think. You can be a Christian, but you are taught that I'm making a spiritual Satan. Physical Christian, spiritual Satan. So you get behind this Satan because of how you think. You are thinking, not like God. Thinking like men. Man. That's why a Christian is more than a man. You know that man can be also used interchangeably. The ordinary person. But man has gender as a human being. We are all human beings. But don't think that you are the same thing with an unbeliever out there.
Mm.
What is the same thing? But the Bible says that which is born of the flesh is of the flesh. That which is born of the spirit. So don't think, if you think the way they think, you get what they get. You get what they get. You get the same experience. By your thoughts. Get behind me, Satan. Because of your thoughts. Thank you. We should praise God.
Amen.
So good teaching consists of teachable moments that help people to get transformed as the teacher breaks through into the mind of his learners. Break through into their mind and their heart. Such that a lot of things will be going on in their mind. And that's how revelation comes. Bah! You just get an idea. It makes it a revelation. Something like that. Praise God.
Amen.
Alright. Two, teach people how to learn. Teach them how to think, teach them how to learn. In Matthew 4, Jesus said to the apostles, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. They were fishers before, but he still wanted them to continue the fishing business, but in a different way. Not of the grand catch fish that will be used for one meal, and that's the end, you know. But when you catch a man, when you catch a fish, the fish ends in death. When you catch a man, the man ends in life. So there's a process of fishing that ends in death. There's a process of fishing that ends in life. Jesus is saying, it's the same fish, but I want you to be transformed from the fishing that ends in death to the one that will end in life. So when you catch a man, you transform him. Himself goes ahead to catch other. When you catch a fish, you give it to him. You sell it out. Praise God.
Amen.
So, in other words, follow me and I will make you. I will teach you, you will learn, and you go and continue the process. Teach people how to learn. Learning is a process. And it is a logical process that follows three steps, what we call the learning synthesis. Learning synthesis. Number one, starting with the whole. Number two,
starting with the whole,
the general, the whole.
Okay.
Then taking it apart, one piece at a time. That is step number two. Step number three is bringing it back to the whole. You start with the whole, all of them. Mm-hmm. That's the first step. Mm-hmm. Like general introduction.
Yes.
Then you now begin to take it part by part, what we call the body of the message, so that it will flow sequentially. Then you bring it back to the whole again. You suffer by way of suffering. This is where there is a difference between knowledge and understanding. There's a difference. Knowledge is the mother of all, but understanding is a higher form of knowledge. If you can do what I have said now, that is the meaning of understanding. For instance, this thing here is a handset. We all know that it's a handset, isn't it?
Yes.
But only the person that understands this mechanic machine, how it works, can do what I've just said with this machine. You bring it like this, as it is, that's number one. Number two, you pieces it. And then later, you couple it again. Then he has understanding. We all know that this is fun. Once you put us to which, bam, that's all many of us know. But there's a rotor inside that makes it a road, many of us don't know. And even if you know, there's someone that will come now and will pieces this fan. Separate the components and later again, couple it. Then he has understanding. But we all know that this is fun, knowledge. So knowledge is the foundation, understanding goes deeper than that. Praise God.
Amen.
That's what Latin, Greek calls parakolauteo. Parakolauteo. Is where you have
understanding.
Not just understanding in Greek, is called synesis. Synesis. But when they say when your understanding is perfect, parakolauteo, para at par. Now, it is gotten from the concept of followership. When the president is visiting or governor, there are many people that follow him. There are people that follow him that stay down there. There are those who come around him, they call out there. But there are those who will walk with him shoulder to shoulder. That is paracola. They are all following, but not in the same. Those who follow afar, they are not going to follow, go walk with him shoulder to shoulder. Only select few. And work with the governor and president shoulder to shoulder. That's what the Greek calls parakola.
Parakola.
Rest. At least your understanding has become perfect. So in Greek, everything has level. Surely it's not like English, it just has one word. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
We are talking about how to teach. One is get people how to think, get people how to learn. We say this is how to make it generalized, break, and then couple. That is learning synthesis. Once you get someone to see the whole, understand how all the processes fit together, and then they can apply this wisdom and duplicate the whole system or process again, you have taught them and they have learned. So if I'm to teach you on how to repair handsets, and I can do what I've just said, bring it, pieces it, couple it back. But you cannot pieces it, couple it back, learning has not taken place. Learning has not taken place. So to teach you how to learn is how to be able to know what you know, how to be able to do what you know. That is why some of God say, I don't want to say this is my point because I have not learned. That means what I'm doing, he cannot do it. But the moment you see that the apprentice can do what the guy is doing, you say, yeah, you are doing for settlement. Your guy will be happy. That tomorrow you say that is his God. But he has duplicated himself in that person. Teaching is duplicating yourself in another person. It becomes an extension of you. get to this level, it begins with understanding and applying learnerology, 101, the theory of the learner. That's what we're going to be looking at now. The first thing you need to understand about self is that as a teacher, you are responsible for learning to occur. You have to take responsibility for learning to occur. That's the first thing you should know. As a teacher, you are responsible for learning to occur. Your journey begins with having this proper understanding. The focus of teaching is not on the teacher. It's on the learner. It's on the learner. Number two, thorough biblical principle teaching does not take place unless the learner, the student, the apprentice, or the teacher's master teaches has learned something. The pupil, the disciple, has learned something, then teaching is not taking place. So, Webster Dictionary defines learn as to come to be able. To learn is to come to be able, ability. And to teach, to cause, to know. To cause, to know. So you are the one to cause that knowledge. That is teaching. Poyo. The Greek word for cause is called poyo. Someone say poyo.
Poyo
means to make, to produce, to cause, to be the means of a thing, to do with the notion of continued rather than completed action. If teaching is to cause you to know, then you have learned if as a result of the teaching, you are now able to do what you are
doing.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Okay. The Bible tells us that teaching means causing to learn. Therefore, teaching is what the teacher does in the student. If you want to know if you are a good teacher, check the student. That's why in the school of pulpit, I was saying that the salubrosity, the level of the spirituality of members is the yardstick for measuring the soundness of teachers. If you come to a prayer group, look at the life of members. That's what makes you to know the teaching ministry. That is whether the teaching ministry is effective or not is in the life of the members. I was discussing with our teachers something I was trying to break the closet for them. I said they are privileged to be here. What many of them, even you must know in our prayer group, many leaders in that diocese don't know it. Can I give the trademark to the taxing leader? We went to it, so he now formed the training committee and made me the chairman to teach other members in that diocese. When we met together to discuss, one of the leaders said something like, he said, no, how can it be? All of us said, that is the truth. You say, you mean it? And he said, just smart, he's a leader in that diocese. The common foundational Christian principle that this person does not even just laugh. That's what we give to people, even the members already know it. So why do we teach? To be able to stabilize and generalize knowledge. That what is known here, this is the concept of writing books, bringing out tapes, manuals, because you cannot be everywhere. You cannot be everywhere. But you can write a book that go everywhere, or go many places that myself probably may not be able to reach. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Are they learning? They are teaching. If they are not learning, you are not teaching. So are you learning anything?
Yes, sir.
That's how we go. Whether I am teaching, I may be speaking, but not teaching. I may be speaking. If not learning. Alright, so as we go into this learnerology, the law of the learner, we'll be looking at what is called maxims. Maxims just mean brief statements that highlight the principle or highlight the truth. So that what we're looking at. Maxim number one. Maxim number one, Maxim, M-A-X-I-M, Maxim. Teachers are responsible to cause students to learn. So if I write it down, that you go home, you go to the maxims and understand what teaching. Students are responsible to learn the material, but the teacher is responsible to cause them to know the material. This requires total commitment to the full as a teacher. The responsibility is to cause them, do everything in your power to make the students to learn. Maxim number two. Teachers will stand accountable to God for their influence. Teachers will stand accountable to God for their influence. I was with the ministry yesterday in the evening, not from where I came to get directed. The question arose in James chapter 3. James said, not many of you should be teachers. They say, well, yeah, discouraging people. I'm judging chief ministers. Praise God.
Amen.
He said, because your own condemnation, your own judgment will be more strict. So God holds teachers responsible. Because there are people who will hear something and they may not have the understanding to go across check. Because it's a teacher that said it. That's all. They will take it. So if you give people something wrong, they will still take it. And they will be living in error, thinking that they are doing what is right. And there are many wrong teachings, wrong concepts going on all over the world. So the message number two, that teachers will stand accountable to God for their influence on the audience. That means I don't have a right to come and say anything I want to say. Because I'm influencing some people. And God will hold me accountable if I influence people negatively. Influence is a responsibility, and God holds those with responsibility accountable. And those who teach will be held more accountable. That is why James 3:1 was saying, not more than many people should be in teaching. Maxim number 3. Teachers are responsible because they control subject, style, and speaker. The 3 S of presentation. Subject, style, and speaker. As teachers, we have tremendous control in the teaching learning process.
Subject,
style, and speaker. The teacher is in charge. We control the subject we talk about. We can change the subject if we want, isn't it? I am the one that chose to give you the topic. Learnerology 101. So I'm in charge. I can call it another thing. I can change it. So teachers are in charge of the subject. If you want, you can give your subject, teach with illustration. If you like, you can teach with jokes, cracking jokes, making people to laugh. If you like, you can teach like an autocrat, dictation, frown your face, keep this time lesson with a good Friday face. It doesn't matter. That is, you are in charge.
Praise God.
That is it. As teachers, we control the style. We can whisper, we can shout, we can stand, we can sit, we can genuflect, face about, stay workplace, and so on and so forth. We can use DVD, projector, to teach style. Are we going to interview by weekend to teach? Are we going with projector? Praise God.
Forever.
We use many things just to get the message across. That's why most times when I have come with your prayer group for to give it to you, project, when I invited you to
retract it.
Yes.
Okay, that's yeah.
I used to project to many different places.
I remember when we had the evangelical ministry to the Dyson conference. One of the teachers I gave. So when they recorded it, more of them telling that people came to buy it. They say, which of the talk do you say? They say, that one that they met was doing like this. Because I used to reject the teach, and it was an animated bed. They say, look at what that bed. Before I could touch it, but they remember that I said, there's some people who like to see something. That's his style. That's his style. That thing they see, they may even forget, but there is something that will make them to remember the message because of what they saw. Style, you are in charge of time. Tell your neighbor you are in charge, right?
Yeah, in charge.
And also, we control the speaker. That means we are the speaker, so we are in charge of ourselves. We wear what we want to wear. We arrive when we want to arrive, early or late. We can choose to be friendly or antagonistic to people. Our friend, we are in charge.
In charge.
Praise God.
Amen.
The things that we are going to be held accountable. There was one day in our prayer room. It was a Bible study or prayer, I can't remember, but the moderator came on suit and tie. Well dressed. The speaker came on kaftan, you know, with a palm. The presence of the moderator
was shadowing to the
speaker. Why did the speaker say, why did I talk to the moderator?
Oh, you did that.
So anytime I have an opportunity to come and stand before people, don't take it for granted. Yeah. Don't take it for granted. Yeah. Be the best. You are in charge, be the best.
Praise God.
Amen.
The best. You are not coming to show clothes.
Yeah.
But
appear neat.
Educate. Don't let what you wear cause distraction to the others.
Yeah.
That is true. And say, praise the Lord. It's yeah. More than they are doing.
Remember the story of the pastor that was preaching and the woman was crying in the crowd.
The pastor was hammering.
The message is ending. The woman was crying.
Just to satisfy him at the end, the pastor called the mama. The mama discovered that all the while I was ministering. Mama, what's happened?
I said, oh, my son, I just came from the village. And when you came out, when I saw you, you are back. Made me to remember the he goat I left at home. And I forgot to take care of the goat.
The mama came for a woman.
I said, no one to take care of the goat. Yeah? So the preacher came out and the bed of the preacher made that man like the goat.
He was missing and making him cry.